In fact, Dallas City Hall is normally a public building, but today it was really under armed guard.
Jack.
Jack Ruby, the carousel. Owner of the carousel shot.
Is this a confirmed report as to who did the shooting?
As far as I know, I just got it from Vic Robertson.
Vic Robertson from City Hall reports that Jack Ruby, the owner of the carousel, which is a bar in Dallas, did the shooting.
The only thing that is clear at this point is that there is not a single police officer in this building who believes that Jack Ruby killed Lee Oswald, if that is proven to be the case, out of patriotic fervor. And that if he is proved to have killed Lee Oswald, it was for one reason only, and that was to seal his lips.
Jack Ruby was no national hero who was just pained by how the death of JFK would have hurt Jacqueline Kennedy, which was his story. That's preposterous on its face.
In the 1970s, G. Robert Blakey was chief counsel to the congressional committee that investigated the assassinations of both JFK and Martin Luther King Jr. Some of those closest to the investigation insist that uncovering Ruby's role is the key to unraveling the entire plot.
With many believing that in order to silence Lee Harvey Oswald, conspirators sent in a hitman named Jack Ruby. This man, apparently waiting for Oswald along with reporters, is Jack Ruby. Why was Ruby there? What was on his mind? Revenge? Or was Jack Ruby a cold-blooded actor in a conspiracy?
The big question now is, what kind of man shot Lee Oswald, and why?
When you have a fellow who 2 days after the assassination of the president shoots the man who's accused of killing the president, and he has mob connections, then you've got to assume there's a conspiracy from the get-go.
The true story of the man who shot Oswald begins not in Dallas, but Chicago, where Jack Ruby was born Jacob Rubenstein.
Ruby, in his early years, began as a runner for members of the mob in Chicago, carrying envelopes that had money from the numbers racket from one place to another.
Author David Scheim spent 15 years researching his book, Contract on America, which documents the links between Jack Ruby and the Mafia.
As a young teenager, Ruby was with a gang of youths that ran errands for Al Capone. His most significant organized crime connection as a youth was as an official in a mob-controlled union.
In 1937, Ruby gets a job as an organizer for the corrupt Scrap Iron and Junk Handlers Union. Ruby's contacts have direct connections to powerful New Orleans mob boss, Carlos Marcello. In fact, Marcello's organization oversees all the mob rackets in Dallas, and Ruby knows his way around the Dallas mob.
Ruby was a frequent visitor and associate of Joseph Savillo, the mafia boss of Dallas.
Keep in mind that in those days, if you had a nightclub in any major city, it was almost unavoidable to have contact with certain elements which controlled entertainment, booze distribution, and so forth.
As owner of the carousel, Jack was well known in certain circles around Dallas, especially in the Dallas Police Department. Jack idolized cops and encouraged members of the Dallas PD and Sheriff's Office to come to the carousel. Jack's club also appealed to other not-so-reputable characters looking for a good time, including members of organized crime. To Ruby, both cops and mobsters had class, something Jack craved but never had. Jack had gained a reputation around Dallas as a wannabe. Jack was also something of a fighter. He had a quick temper and even quicker fists, earning him the nickname Sparky among his friends. On over a dozen occasions during the 3 years the carousel was open, Jack publicly beat customers bloody with his fists, brass knuckles, or the butt of his Colt 38. Ruby beat one of his musicians so badly, the man had to bite off the tip of Jack's finger to get Jack away from him.
To say that he had no connections to organized crime, it's just bizarre. The women that he had in the strip club in Dallas were on a circuit that included the Show Bar in New Orleans, a bar owned by Carlos Marcello's brother.
The mob felt that the Kennedys had double-crossed them on a deal in the 1960 presidential election. That Joe Kennedy had come to some of the mob big shots and said, please support Jack for president. As soon as Kennedy was elected, one of his first appointments with Bobby Kennedy as Attorney General, and the first thing that Bobby Kennedy did was go after organized crime.
In Bobby Kennedy's sights are Sam Giancana, godfather of the Chicago outfit. Johnny Roselli is Giancana's man in Vegas and Hollywood. The boss in Tampa, Florida, Santo Traficante Jr., maintains strong ties in Cuba and a close partnership with Louisiana kingpin Carlos Marcello. In 1961, unable to indict Marcello, Bobby Kennedy pressures immigration authorities to deport him to Guatemala, the country Marcello falsely claimed as his birthplace.
They put him in handcuffs, put him on an airplane. And Carlos Marcello was a man with a great deal of dignity. And the notion that somebody else would put their hands on him is an insult, a major insult.
Kennedy had federal agents kidnap Marcello when Marcello went to report to the Immigration and Naturalization Service and office in New Orleans. They took him and put him on a plane and dropped him off in Guatemala.
And Marcello was livid. This was America's most powerful godfather. All the time, he's cursing Bobby Kennedy, whom he blames for everything.
It takes weeks. But according to the Border Patrol, Carlos Marcello gets his close associate and pilot, David Ferry, to sneak him back into the U.S.
Unknown to JFK, the CIA was continuing to work with Traficante, Roselli, and Sam Giancana in a secret plot to kill Fidel Castro. Carlos Marcello very colorfully explained that if you have a dog and you cut off its tail, meaning Bobby Kennedy, the head of the dog, meaning JFK, will turn around and bite you. But if you cut off the head of the dog, meaning kill JFK, then the tail quits wagging on its own. So the Mafia developed their plan to kill JFK, and the first attempt was not in Dallas, but it was actually planned for Chicago.
Secret Service agent Abraham Bolden was one of 13 agents in Chicago preparing for the president's visit on November 2nd, 1963.
About the end of October, we began hearing rumors of an assassination squad that followed him from Miami, as we understood.
A day before the president is due in Chicago, the Miami intercepts take on sudden urgency.
A lady called the U.S. Secret Service office. She said that she was a landlady in a building where there were two Cubans were staying. And she went in to do something in the apartment, and she saw four rifles in the room. Also in the room there was a newspaper, and she thought it was turned to the route that President Kennedy was supposed to take.
The Secret Service puts the group under surveillance.
During the process of keeping them under surveillance, one of the agents got too close to one of the suspects. In fact, that the suspect heard his radio go off, and right away they began to pack up and they fled.
2 hours before JFK's planned motorcade, Chicago police stop Thomas Arthur Valley. In the trunk of his car, they find an M1 rifle and 3,000 rounds of ammunition. Even more troubling, agents learn that Valley works in a printing company that overlooks the president's motorcade route.
Valley had several interesting parallels to Lee Harvey Oswald. He was an ex-Marine like Oswald. Both Valley and Oswald at the same time got jobs along the projected motorcade route for JFK.
At 9:15 a.m., as eager bystanders line the president's motorcade route, JFK's press secretary abruptly announces the cancellation of the president's trip.
The Mafia didn't have three different plans to kill JFK. They had one plan and tried it in three different cities. The second city where they tried was 4 days before Dallas and Tampa, Florida.
One of the masterminds behind the plot, Carlos Marcello, though 500 miles away on trial in a New Orleans courthouse, has things under control in Dallas.
The assassination happened in Dallas, Marcello's territory.
On three occasions during a two-day period, Marcello remarked, quote, "That Kennedy, that smiling MF, we'll fix him in Dallas. We are going to get that Kennedy in Dallas."
A series of high-profile federal prosecutions in New York and Chicago
has incensed the country's top mafia dons, the so-called National Commission. This intense hatred of the Kennedys was something new for the mafia. In fact, after the 1960 presidential election, Chicago mob boss Sam Giancana boasted that he had stuffed the ballot boxes on the city's west side, ensuring that Illinois went for Kennedy over Richard Nixon.
Giancana had reason to be confident in his relationship with the United States government. The CIA had invited him to take part in a bizarre plot to murder Fidel Castro. The mafia were the fall guys. If the operation was discovered, they, not the government, would take the blame. The prize, the return of their Cuban casinos. The idea was put to Johnny Rosselli, Giancana's man in Hollywood, by a CIA contact.
He thought I was kidding at first. Then he became stupefied. And after a few more drinks, he knew I was telling the truth.
Days before Kennedy was shot, a New Orleans bar girl was admitted to a hospital where she made startling claims to doctors.
She said it was very common knowledge in the underworld figures in New Orleans that there was a contract out on John F. Kennedy and that he would be assassinated. She gave no specifics, but she made it very clear, and she told a number of the staff in the hospital there that this was going to happen before it happened.
She worked in a bar in New Orleans owned by the family of Carlos Marcello, the city's mafia chief.
Lee Harvey Oswald had lifelong family ties to Carlos Marcello's organization. He had an uncle who had become a bookmaker in the Marcello organization.
When Oswald was arrested for disturbing the peace in New Orleans, he was sprung from jail by a man who had close connections to the Marcello organization.
I've always felt very threatened. You know, a lot of folks that gave testimony are no longer around to give testimony any longer. I didn't want to become a statistic. I didn't want to be one of those people that shot myself in the back of the head with a shotgun. Ruby introduced me to the man sitting there at the table with he and Jada, and he said, "Beverly, this is my friend, Lee." And after Jack Ruby went into the police station and killed Lee Harvey Oswald, it was then that I realized this was the man that I had met in the club 2 weeks prior to the assassination of Kennedy. Lee Harvey Oswald and Jack Ruby were linked together, and I don't know how, and probably I never will.
Well, sure enough, turns out his uncle is a bookmaker for Carlos Marcello.
Oswald also appears in this 1955 photo with one of Carlos Marcello's closest associates.
This is Oswald. Before he goes into the Marines, he was in a civil air patrol, and the individual who leads the young men is a man named David Ferry. David Ferry turns out to be the private investigator for Carlos Marcello.
Weeks immediately before the assassination of the president, unaccountably, Ruby had visits from some members of the underworld who he had not even seen in a period of something like 20 years.
Ruby is his man in Texas. He's running his organizations there. He's skimming off of Marcello. He owes him. He owes him big. He could have had him killed, but he didn't. He kept him in his pocket for what he was planning.
Then, Blakey believes, at some point on November 22, 1963, the mob offers its old friend Jack Ruby the biggest job of his life.
They go to him and say, Jack, we want you to do us a favor. You know the cops. The cops come in your strip joint all the time. You give them free liquor. You can get into the police station. Shoot Oswald for us. You've got to take him out.
Blakey believes the mob makes Ruby the classic offer he cannot refuse.
Now, what does Ruby now know? He's been offered a chance to be a close associate. He's also got knowledge that they did the assassination if they want to take out the assassin. So he either knows I do it or I'm dead, which is the standard mob technique. You have one shooter kill the man, and you have somebody else kill the second guy.
Billy Grammer was a police communications officer on duty the night before Ruby killed Oswald. Around 9 p.m., he received an urgent message from a caller who refused to identify himself.
I thought I recognized the voice, but at the same time, I could not put a face or a name with the voice. And as we talked, he began telling me that we needed to change the plans on moving Oswald from the basement, that he knew of the plans to make the move, and if we did not make a change, the statement he made precisely was, we are going to kill him.
Billy Grammer reported the call, finished his shift, and went home to bed. He was asleep when Ruby, seen here on the edge of picture in his gray fedora, prepared to move in for the kill.
Here is the prisoner. Do you have anything to say to your friend?
The first Billy Grammer knew of the slaying was the following morning when he switched on his television set.
No sooner than I turned it on and they were telling that Jack Ruby had killed Oswald, then I suddenly realized, you know, knowing Jack Ruby the way I did, this was the man I was talking to on the phone last night. At that time, I put the voice with the face, and I knew within myself that Jack Ruby is the one that made that call to me the night before. And I think it was obvious because he knew me and I knew him, and he called me by name over the telephone. And seeing this and knowing what I knew and what he had said, then to me it had to be Jack Ruby. He made the statement, we are going to kill him, which leads me to believe that this was not a spontaneous thing that happened on the spur of the moment. He was watching Oswald coming out the door and all of a sudden he decided to shoot him. I do not believe that. I think this was a planned event with him being the man to do the shooting.
At Parkland Hospital, minutes after the tragedy, one member of the press corps who knew Jack Ruby well was to have an extraordinary encounter. Reporter Seth Cantor.
Just after I entered, there was a group of nurses and doctors standing around with a lot of concern, and Jack Ruby came up to me. He said something to the effect that, isn't this just terrible? And I guess that encounter with Ruby took maybe 25, 30 seconds. It was very clear to me who I had talked to and who I had called by name and who had called me by name and who I had shaken hands with and everything. But when the Warren Commission report came out, they said that probably under the stress of everything that was going on, that I most likely was confused and that I talked to Ruby at the police station several hours later.
Ruby denied he'd been at Parkland, and the Warren Commission believed him rather than Seth Cantor.
I was dismayed when I picked up my copy of the Warren Commission report and discovered what they had decided about my testimony. And among other things, I immediately began to wonder, you know, who else they had talked to, who they chose not to believe, and why.
A pristine bullet, which the commission was to allege had wounded both Kennedy and Connolly, magically appeared on a stretcher at Parkland. Jack Ruby's coincidental appearance inside the hospital was not the only fact the commissioners chose to ignore. Jack Ruby's close links with the Dallas police gave him easy access to their headquarters. On the assassination weekend, he was seen there several times.
There's no way in the world, with today's idea of security, that a fellow like Jack Ruby should be in the place where the accused assassin is. And he has his gun with him that night. We know it because there's a picture of Jack taken from the back. You can see the bulge in the back of his jacket.
Around midnight, suspect Lee Harvey Oswald was led out of room 317 to the basement for a press conference. Jack was standing in the hallway a few feet away, a loaded .38 in his pocket. Ruby followed the crowd of reporters into the assembly room in the basement. Standing on a table in the back, he was one of several people who corrected District Attorney Henry Wade when the DA gave the wrong name for Oswald's Fair Play for Cuba Committee. On Saturday, Jack was spotted at the police station again.
This investigation has been carried on jointly by the FBI, the Secret Service, the Rangers, and the Dallas Police Department. Captain Fritz has been in charge.
He knows, I think, when Oswald was being moved because the cops told him Jack Ruby stalked Lee Harvey Oswald.
At 11:20 a.m., television cameras are rolling as the elevator door opens and Oswald emerges, handcuffed to a detective.
Here in the base of the Dallas Police Headquarters, detectives have their guns drawn. He's been shot. Lee Oswald has been shot. There's the man with a gun. Absolute panic here in the base of the Dallas Police Headquarters. Oswald has been shot.
We have arrested the man. The man will be charged with murder.
Who is he?
The suspect's name is Jack Rubenstein, I believe. He goes by the name of Jack Ruby.
In the immediate aftermath of the shooting, Jack gave a handful of different reasons for pulling the trigger.
He's told Patrick Dean, a Dallas police sergeant, that he had seen Oswald in the police station on Friday night, saw Oswald smirking, decided at that point that he was going to kill Lee Harvey Oswald.
Jack told other interrogators that afternoon he was so moved by the plight of Jackie Kennedy and her fatherless children, he took justice into his own hands. Soon after, Jack gave a third explanation. He wanted to prove that Jews had guts.
6 days after Ruby arrives at the Dallas County Jail, he receives one of his first visitors, Joseph Campisi, the number two man in the Dallas mob.
Somebody has to go in and comfort him. And that's exactly what Campisi did. He has got to keep Ruby on board. Ruby's volatile. He succeeded in doing what he's doing. He's got to go talk to him. Jack, you're our friend. We're with you. The local cops in Dallas at this time are corrupt. They're being paid off. And so when he is in the local jail, he is vulnerable to being taken out himself.
Ruby will hint that he has secrets about the assassination that he won't or can't divulge. June 1964, more than 6 months after the assassination of John F. Kennedy. Members of the Warren Commission, including Supreme Court Chief Justice Earl Warren and then Congressman Gerald Ford, travel to the Dallas County Jail to question Jack Ruby.
All through the interview, he says, get me out of here. Take me to Washington. I'll tell you what happened.
Earl Warren said, if you believe your life is in danger in talking to us, then I would advise you don't tell us anything. This is the chief investigator for America talking to probably the single most important witness in the case. Don't talk to us.
In the end, the commission decides not to take Ruby to Washington. More than a year later, in September of 1965, after the Warren Commission has announced its findings, Ruby gives a press conference. In it, he delivers a cryptic message.
Everything pertaining to what's happening has never come to the surface. The world will never know the true facts of what occurred, my motives. The people that had so much to gain and had such an ulterior motive for putting me in a position I'm in will never let the true facts come above board to the world.
Now, these people are in very high positions, Jack?
Yes.
In 1966, nearly 3 years after Oswald's murder, an appeals court overturns Ruby's first-degree murder conviction on a technicality. As soon as he gets a new trial venue, Ruby hopes to plead guilty to the lesser charge of murder without malice and walk out of jail with time served. 3 weeks later, Jack Ruby dies.
Doctors discovered he was suffering with terminal cancer of the liver, lungs, and brain.
We were working on projects that might have to do with eventually competing with Russia on the matter of using cancer as a bioweapon.
In 1979, the House Select Committee on Assassinations re-examines the evidence and concludes that Kennedy was most likely the victim of a conspiracy. The committee report suggests that Ruby was ordered to kill Lee Harvey Oswald to keep Oswald from talking. The committee releases its report on January 3, 1979. It states that there is a, quote, high probability that a second gunman fired a shot from the infamous grassy knoll. Their conclusion? Oswald most likely did not act alone. Therefore, Kennedy was probably the victim of a conspiracy.
The report said, yes, there was a conspiracy. There were at least two people firing at President Kennedy. Much of the evidence leading toward involvement of government investigative agencies, perhaps in the actual murder, perhaps just in the cover-up, were all pretty much glossed over. During the House Assassinations Committee hearings, the FBI and CIA admitted that they had withheld evidence, that they had obstructed justice.
I got no stake in this. I say this as a way a reasonable person has come out after spending a substantial time, 2 years of my life and $5 million of your money, trying to figure out what happened and listening to things thereafter. This is the most plausible explanation. It's not the one I went in with. I went in thinking they didn't do it. And I found myself being persuaded by the evidence to the contrary.
But even Blakey's critics are intrigued by startling new information released in 2001 that may link New Orleans mob boss Carlos Marcello, Lee Harvey Oswald, and the CIA.
The agency has never cooperated in the investigation of the president's death.
August 1963, 40-year-old George Ioannidis is a CIA operative in Miami. On orders from the agency, he is secretly financing and guiding a violent commando squad of anti-Castro Cuban refugees called the Cuban Student Directorate, and known by their Spanish acronym, the DRE.
There are some significant people who played roles with the anti-Castro Cubans. Carlos Marcello financed anti-Castro Cuban groups.
The final element in this complex matrix of associations is none other than Lee Harvey Oswald. On August 5th, 1963, Oswald makes an attempt to infiltrate the DRE, a move that 4 days later results in a public confrontation with DRE members. This intriguing incident connects Oswald, the anti-Castro commando squad, and the CIA. The House committee was familiar with the incident, but it never knew about the CIA's role in this tangled web of associations, for the simple reason that the CIA never told the committee about it.
Our investigators went over there. They were looking for conspiracy, and they were young and obnoxious, and they pressed. And I thought, when the agency complained to me, that they were too aggressive.
The CIA then suggested a central contact person for the House committee. It was none other than George Ioannidis.
I would have wanted to know, when Oswald infiltrated this group, how did the group report up to Ioannidis? What did Ioannidis do or say about it? Was he in a position to have edited what got to us? Yes.
Once the committee set up its operation, it began to investigate a number of CIA personnel. One of the CIA agents under suspicion was a counterintelligence specialist named William Harvey.
Could you tell this committee who the individuals were involving mafia chieftains or organized crime figures?
As far as I'm aware, on that particular situation, it was William K. Harvey who was in touch with John Roselli, and it was Harvey and Roselli who were attempting to find, if I understood it correctly, some channel from Florida into Havana.
Why was Harvey under investigation? William King Harvey, known throughout intelligence as the American James Bond, was assigned by Deputy Director Richard Bissell and Director of Plans Richard Helms to head an executive action program for the CIA, which was created to develop assassination attempts against foreign leaders. Harvey had held many positions over the years that made him suspicious to the committee. Besides his relationship with Roselli, he was one of only three people involved in a covert program to send false defectors into the Soviet Union, and was undoubtedly aware of Oswald's defection. As head of the executive action program to assassinate Castro, he developed a profile of the ideal assassin. In his handwritten notes for the program, codenamed ZR Rifle, he defines the ideal assassin as a person with communist credentials that can be used if the cover is blown. Finally, Harvey hated the Kennedys. After the Cuban Missile Crisis, he had a confrontation with Bobby Kennedy that virtually ended his career, exiling him to an intelligence station in Rome. As the House Committee would learn, Harvey maintained his friendship with Johnny Roselli long after his exile to Rome. It was this connection that was of serious interest to the committee, and they wanted to ask Harvey about it. Unfortunately, Harvey died of a massive heart attack within weeks of his scheduled testimony.
Not long afterwards, the dismembered body of Johnny Roselli, Giancana's partner in the Castro murder plot, was found stuffed in an oil drum in the sea off Miami.
Sam Giancana told my father that we took care of Kennedy together, that elements of the CIA, along with members of the mob, joined together to assassinate the President of the United States, that they each had equal reason to make sure that Kennedy did no longer remain in office.
Santa telephones me, and he said that he had to see me. He had some very important things to discuss with me.
Santo suggested that they go and take a drive in my father's car. Santo was using my father as a priest to confess his final sins before he died.
Anxious and ailing, the frail godfather begins a monologue of regrets and recriminations covering a lifetime of crime.
All of a sudden, out of the clear blue sky, he said, Carlos, we should have killed Bobby instead of Giovanni. And of course, Giovanni, he meant John Kennedy is what he meant.
So what do you conclude about the agency? You have to conclude that they don't tell the truth to the government for which they work about the most important single thing that happened in the 1960s, John Kennedy's death.
I view his legacy as one of damage, one that not only took a person's life in terms of Lee Harvey Oswald, but took away from us, the American people, the chance to learn the real truth about why Jack Kennedy died in November of 63.
The mob killed our president. And they got away with it.